Purdue has already scored a touchdown. Minnesota had a very short first possession, and Darkin's second carry terminated early by O'Keefer. Let's take a look at that Purdue defense, and Jim Coletto hopes it's an improved defense from 1994. Darkin's has not had much running room so far. Frick moved over from his defensive tackle spot a couple of games ago. He plays defensive end, and O'Keefer, as we mentioned, the leading tackler for the Boilermakers. And an inexperienced secondary, one that Minnesota hopes to exploit. Darkins again gets the ball. He muscles his way across the 25. That was a Mike Allstott type of run for Chris Darkins.
And he's able to do that. He's a 220-pound running back. Don't see him do that a lot. Usually he's trying to outrun someone on the sidelines or making cuts, but he's able to do that when he gets the opportunity.
Bob O'Connor with the tackle for Purdue.
One of the things the Gophers want to do is spread out the offense, Dick, and give Dawkins a little bit more running room inside. If they bunch up with a big tight end, they're not going to give Dawkins as much room inside, and they feel that maybe they won't have as much strength on the inside as Purdue does.
Got to watch the guy at the bottom of your screen, Ryan Fellwell, out of the shotgun, Minnesota. With the flare to Darkin, to the 30, to the 40, and out of bounds. A Minnesota first down. They'll mark him out of bounds at the 38-yard line. Derek Winston pinched him out of bounds along the near sideline.
This is a design play all the time. Fellwell and Atwell on the top of the screen. They go inside. They bring people down. You get Darkins out there, man up. He just has too much speed. That's a defensive back. He just has too much speed. He gets out with the first down.
Darkins has handled the ball about a half dozen times already tonight with no apparent injury problem. Sutter throws incomplete at the 45-yard line. Fellwell's had problems hanging on to the football so far. He caught one and fumbled it. That one he probably should have caught.
That's a nice play by the defensive back, Derek Winston. He comes up. Again, Fellwell has the great speed. You have to give him a little bit of room. But he came up. He made that little turn-in pattern, and Winston hit him just as the ball came, knocked it right out. It should have been caught, but that's a great play by Derek Winston. You see him right there. He's wearing the nose. Wearing the Band-Aid on the nose.
Breathe right. Before he's finally tackled by Jamel Coleman. Darkin's longest carry of the game so far.
Purdue
pick up of about 8 yards.
Purdue was guessing run that time. They were guessing to the outside. They blitzed O'Keefer from the top of the screen. The play was coming down on this side. Good thing. Otherwise, O'Keefer would have been able to make that shot. But Minnesota guessed right. They came away from. Darkin's had a nice hole. Picked up about 9 yards.
7-0 Purdue. 20 to play in the first quarter. Four tight ends in for Minnesota. Darkins hit at the line, and he will not get first down yardage. The first man there for Purdue, Willie Burroughs. And then Jamel Coleman finished him off.
Gophers have some big, strong tight ends, and they feel that they can out-muscle people when they bring these tight ends in. That time, they got stuck at the line of scrimmage when they turned up to make a block. The linebackers, the defensive linemen pushed them back. They didn't get an opportunity to get a good strike. Darkins doesn't get anywhere.
Big stand on third down for Purdue, forcing Minnesota to punt. Harrison Harmon will kick it away. Craig Allen stands back at about his 15-yard line. Nice kick by Harmon. Harmon fumbles on a flag is thrown. Fumbled the ball at the 10, but he was not given the 3-yard cushion needed. And it looked as if Minnesota's Marie Moore got a little bit too close to Craig Allen.
This is a penalty, Dick, we've seen called before. Moore has no idea where Allen is, where the ball's coming down. He's trying to get in position to make a tackle. That's the correct call, according to the rules. It's a very hard play for a punt cover man to not make. It's a very difficult play.
7:23 left in the first quarter.
The inside the
Purdue will have the football.
On the kicking team, 5 yards, first down.
what they've tried to do with this rule, Dick, is to give the receiver more room. It makes a very exciting play to give him an opportunity to catch that ball, get upfield. You have to give him 2 yards. As a punt cover person, your job, you're the first one down, is to take a shot. It doesn't matter so much if you miss the tackle. Just make him go sideways, let your other people come up. It's a very difficult play.
A 5-yard mark off against Minnesota. The line of scrimmage, the 16. Out of bounds at about the 22-yard line. Rodney Heath came up from his quarterback spot to make the hit on Rodgers, but not until he picked up about 7 yards.
What happens in a situation like this, Purdue's having such an outstanding time running the ball. What's going to happen, the Gophers are going to have to come back with some blitzes, some rundown blitzes, bring a linebacker. Purdue realizes that. When they see the Gophers start doing that, they'll go back to the pass and play action, try and get someone up and match that man-to-man. Minnesota, Purdue doesn't throw very often to their tight ends, but Stevens with a nice catch here. Kretzker has all kinds of time. There's no rush at all. Langford's back behind him. Stevens is a big man. Bounces off Langford. Langford gets about 2 more yards.
Gain of 9 on the play. Second and 1. Allstott gets head on, and he falls forward across the 40 for a Purdue first down. Craig Sauer made the tackle for Minnesota.
Gophers blitz that time, realizing the short yardage, expecting that exact play. We're going to see the blitz coming from the inside. You can see Langford right up the middle. He just gets bumped off. Otherwise, he would have got Allstott in the backfield. And boy, Allstott is alone. Once he puts that head down, you need more than one person to put him on the ground. Coming wide. He doesn't know where to go. The Gophers get a great push up the field. Turn him back in. He's got nowhere to go. He loses a yard and a half.
Jerome Davis, the right defensive end, got good penetration into the backfield and forced Rodgers a little bit wider than he would have liked. Purdue's first, third down situation in the quarter. Tesker, a lateral pass to Allstott. He breaks one tackle and is wrapped up for a loss of another yard or so. Dangerous play because it was a lateral pass. Allstott's got very good hands, and he made sure of the catch there, even though he lost a yard on the play.
Dick, that's an extremely dangerous play, and I don't think it is set up that way. We're going to see it. Tresper stopped his drop. He ended up throwing backwards. He did not want to be. He's not supposed to be. You can see Allstott again. That's an outstanding player. He just broke that tackle. Justin Casinas is an outstanding player. Allstott runs by him, but again, nowhere to go.
Rob Dagnon, an outstanding punter. He's standing at the 25. Here comes the rush. about the 36-yard line. Wayne Francis and Willie Burroughs combined on the tackle for Purdue. Minnesota from their 36-yard line. Minnesota first down, near midfield, Chris Darkins picks up a first down before Jamel Coleman knocks it out of bounds.
Purdue had an opportunity. They've done well defensively until the last series. The Gophers had an opportunity to do some things. Darkins looks healthy. You can see here some nice blocks downfield. Setting up that block, goes around him. Woodson's blocking for him. Darkins is moving straight ahead. What Purdue has done is they brought Joe Hagan into the game as a linebacker. He played safety last year. They're really playing a five defensive back with two linebackers right now, four down linemen, trying to get more speed in the game.
Pass batted down behind the line of scrimmage by Purdue's Donnell Howard. It'll be second down and 10. Let's go down to the field and Mike Max.
I tell you what, Purdue's big concern coming into the game, talking to some of their assistant coaches, was that they didn't have real good film on the Gophers this year. Because against Arkansas State, they used a lot of second and third teamers. They were concerned, and they did not know what to expect from Chris Darkins. That's why they felt that pass out of the backfield may be effective tonight.
Second and 10 for Minnesota. Sauter with plenty of time. Throw was intended for Atwell, incomplete at the 45-yard line, knocked down along the far sideline by Willie Burroughs.
And Willie Burroughs was waiting for that pass. He was hoping Sauter was going to throw that pass. Sauter did. If it would have been thrown a little bit better, Willie Burroughs would have gone down the sidelines. He baited Sauter on that time and just dared him to make that throw.
Burroughs didn't play at all last year. He injured a knee in the first fall practice. Third and 10 for Minnesota. Sauter throws complete. Fellwell inside the 35 down to the 32-yard line. And there once again for Purdue, Willie Burroughs along with Derek Winston.
See Sauter, he's checking it out. Derek Winston actually leaned a little bit inside to Atwell. He respected Atwell, and there was Thelwell just in the outside.
Derek Winston tackled Thelwell. Winston with a 23-yard interception return last week in Purdue's win over Ball State. Thelwell out, Lee Hunt in for Minnesota. First and 10 on the Purdue 32. Circus hit hard as he got to the 27. A pickup of about 5 yards. Made the tackle. O'Keefer playing with a broken bone in his right wrist. That's what the wrap is all about. But nonetheless, as we mentioned, he's Purdue's leading tackler this year.
He's been in double digits every game this year. An outstanding player.
Purdue will blitz from time to time. They blitzed a lot here 2 years ago. That's one of the reasons the score got up into the 50s. And O'Keefer had 3 sacks on the year for Purdue. Getting him low was Darnell Howard, junior from Cincinnati.
There we see Joe Hagans. What Purdue has done is they've taken Hall out. They put Hagans in. Hagans played safety last year. What Purdue's really playing right now is five defensive backs. You see him going out now. He's been playing five defensive backs, two linebackers, four down linemen, trying to get more speed in the game, contain Dawkins a little bit, and also help out in the pass plays to Atwell and Thelwell.
Third and 2 for Minnesota. Hanging in motion. Darkins falls across the 20 to about the 19. That's enough for a Minnesota first down. Derek Brown and Jamie Waschel made the tackle for Purdue.
That play is designed to go outside. Darkins sees a little seam. back up the middle. This play's designed. He's got all the strength outside. They're trying to hook some people outside. Cradleville, Darkin sees the seam, cuts back inside, and gets that first down.
Minnesota first down from the Purdue 19.
Purdue's a little confused right now. They're trying to make some adjustments. We're stronger than you are. You can see how Purdue got off the ball on the inside. They're pushing it back. That's an outstanding play. And then the linebackers fill. That's an outstanding play by the defensive line. And that's what really made the play. The defensive line getting across the line of scrimmage, pushing the guards back into the lead block, lead Bob Walker, who at that time was proud of number 80.
Bob O'Connor and others in on the tackle for Purdue. Sauter snips it. Scores Minnesota's first touchdown of the game.
Sauter sees a little hole right here. He just goes right in. That's a linebacker's job to fill, but there's just no way O'Connor can get there quick enough. Sauter sneaks right underneath him for an easy touchdown.
Quarter. True to form, we've had just one punt so far in the football game.
That's what the Gophers need to do, running pass.
Corey Sauter's been doing a lot of handing off to Chris Darkins already in this game. Darkins has already carried the ball 10 times.
That has to be one of the nicest things for the Gopher coaches to realize that so far Darkins is healthy. Played only, he carried the ball only three times all last game, sat out most of the game. He's looked good so far.
Joe Hagans and Lee Johnson back to receive Chalberg's kick. Hagans from the five. Flag is thrown as Hagans runs it out to the 33, maybe the 34-yard line. The flag thrown back at the 25. It's the second straight time that the Boilermakers, I think, have been called for a penalty. Same penalty call as well. Block in the back. The Boilermakers will to give away some kick return yardage by Joe Hagan.
What happens in this situation?
Above the waist, on the receiving team, 10 yards, and final foul, first down.
As you're back receiving that ball, as you're one of them, and you've already, you know who you're going to block as they come down. Sometimes they get a little wiggle on you, they get around you, and you just try and push out. You reach out with your hands instead of staying in tight, and it's so easy to do. You see it so often on running back kicks and punts sometimes. It's just so easy to do. You want to make sure you get your hands on them, and you reach out those arms and push someone in the back.
Last time Purdue returned a kick and had the same penalty, it didn't bother them much. They were moved back to the 10-yard line, and 10 plays later, they were in the end zone. Now from the 15, first and 10. Chester keeps. Throws complete to the 28-yard line. A great catch by Isaac Jones. Ball was thrown a little bit behind him, but Jones made a fine catch, and the Boilermakers get a first down.
Trester comes out again. The Gopher coach is expecting a run with the two running backs they have. Makes a nice fake. Finds Jones, and again, Jones is going down. He makes it out. Look at that catch. It's just just does not get any better than that. Rodney Heath is all over him. We'll see it one more time. That ball is behind him. That's as good as it gets. That's an outstanding catch.
Be able to get this snap off before the end of the quarter. And they did not. No snap, no play. That's the end of the first quarter. Each team has scored a touchdown once. Each team has turned it over once. And each team has punted once in the first quarter.
Obviously, he's having a discussion, but he's not going to win that one.
It is first and 10 for Purdue. And they're on 27. Edwin Watson in the game for Purdue. Trester rolls. Throws deep. It is caught at midfield. And out of bounds. Brian Alford was wide open for the Boilermakers. And Trester, an awkward throw, threw a good ball.
This is a mixed-up in coverage. Rodney Heath lets him go. He thinks he has Rashawn Early over the top, but he doesn't. He thought they're playing what they call a double man, where you have a safety covering up deep for you. He does not. Rodney Heath lets him go short. You see there, he's wide open. Everything Purdue has done offensively right now has been working. Running the ball, play action pass on first down. The Gophers have not stopped anything yet.
And finally is tackled by Crawford Jordan as he gets to the 42. Allstott thought about leaving the Boilermakers after his junior year. He was projected to be drafted in the second round and decided to come back for his senior year. He may end up with all sorts of Purdue rushing records. He already owns a number of them. Last year was the first time a Purdue running back had gained 1,000 yards since 1976, and it looks like Allstott will do it in back-to-back seasons. Trester keeps. Langford chases him. Trester spins and is hit hard at the 32-yard line. A Purdue first down, but at what cost? Trester appears to be all right. He turned right into Antoine Richard and Rashawn Early for Minnesota.
You see Trester beats Langford to the sidelines, cuts back inside, makes a little spin, and boy, he pays for it right there.
Jerome Davis made the hard hit for Minnesota.
This, it looked like Langford got hurt. They're playing Park Williams in at the middle linebacker now. Deion White did not practice this week. Park Williams is in the middle linebacker, and that time the Gopher defense had a hard time setting up, getting people in the right spot. We'll see if that has an effect here for Purdue's offense.
Purdue first down. The first man there for Minnesota, Peter Hiestand. We'll see where they mark it. It looks like they are going to advance the chains, and they are. But Mike Allstott has had some shoulder problems. He has not had the benefit of a lot of practice time over the last several weeks.
That's right, Dick. And he's going to have to do that all season long. Again, not only he's hitting somebody in every play. Again, if a fullback, whether he's carrying the ball or he's blocking for Rodgers or Watson, he is constantly bothering. People are looking for him. They're trying to take a shot at him, too.
Another Purdue first down. and comes up with it for Minnesota. Gophers are doing a better job of tackling the football than they are of tackling Mike Allstott.
Right now, the Gophers are, Mike Allstott is stopping himself, Purdue is stopping himself. Everything they're doing on offense, running, passing, everything is working. You see the hole there, the great run, two and three times, he's breaking tackles.
Terrence Blaine stripped it free and early came up with the loose ball.
But that's just a tremendous run, going back and forth. But Blaine comes in, knocks that ball out, and again, that's the only thing right now that's stopping Purdue.
And no one feels worse about it than Mike Allstott. His second fumble deep in Minnesota territory. Darkins has the football. Prattville leading the way. And Darkins spilled as he crosses the 20-yard line out to the 22. Willie Burroughs made the tackle for the Boilermakers.
One thing Purdue is doing very well is they're pursuing the ball. That's a nice long game, but that play took a long time to set up, and they had eight or nine people around the ball on that play. That's one thing Purdue's defense, they felt, did not do very well in the last year, is run to the ball, try and get someone around the ball at all times. They're doing a much better job this year on defense.
Second and three for Minnesota.
Sada came up the line of scrimmage. He looked at the defense. He saw that Hagans again was in. They're playing that five defensive back, two linebacker, four down lineman set. And they have something they want to run against that. They did it this time. And Purdue came up in a good stop.
Third and short as Minnesota will use the shotgun. Sauter got rid of it too late. Or was it a fumble? They're setting up the fumble, and it's recovered, I believe, by Minnesota at the 20. Darkins was wide open along the near side, but Sauter never saw him. Ryan Thelwell covered it for Minnesota.
Purdue had a good push up the middle. Sauter took too long. He had time. We'll see right here. He has time to make a decision. He looks at one man, then another. Right there, that ball's got to be going. He pulls it back in. Not sure what to do. Purdue gets a good hit from the backside. The ball's up in the air.
Will kick it away. He stands at about his 5-yard line. Craig Allen back at his 38. High snap. Here come the Boilermakers. And Harmon gets away. A low, wobbly spiral. Fielded out a fly by Allen. And Allen is knocked out of bounds at about the 39-yard line. And a late flag thrown in along the far sideline. And that will probably be marked off against Minnesota.
That play was set, return was set up by a great block by Derek Brown. Came back and picked up the first man down for the Gophers. Just an outstanding block that let him get around the outside.
Ooh, penalty will come against Purdue. 9:34 left in the first half. 7-7 our score in Minneapolis.
And welcome back to the Metrodome. It is all time. 7-7. Purdue with the football. Stopping Mike Allstott has been no easy chore for the Gophers. They may have to do it the remainder of the night without middle linebacker Ben Langford. He left the game with a separated shoulder. Last week, two other middle linebackers were injured. That meant this week, Huff Williams was switched from outside linebacker to middle linebacker. He told me 2 days ago he's still about 2 weeks away from being comfortable there.
Thanks, Mike Tressor, going back, throwing deep along the sideline. The 10-yard line, Craig Allen, with a great catch, beating double coverage, Rashawn Hurley and Rodney Heath were both there, but Tresker threw it right on the money.
You see here, Tresker going back, we're playing a zone here, the Gophers are playing a zone. Rodney Heath just lets the man get behind him, early to the inside, that's an outstanding throw, outstanding catch.
Inside the 10-yard line, it's first and 10, Purdue. Rodgers and Allstott. for this quarterback.
That doesn't happen often, but again, Trefster, that may be the only thing that stops him today, is Trefster getting his feet tangled up with him, because the Gophers so far have not been able to figure Mike Allstott out. Well, I shouldn't find that surprising based on past performance, though, Dick.
That's the only time he's been hit in the backfield, the first contact he's had. Let's take a look at our Cinex Land O'Lakes leaderboard. Mike Allstott, the leader for the Boilermakers, an all-time touchdown scored on the ground, and 10 of those touchdowns have come at the expense of Minnesota. Second and goal from the six. Allstott gets another carry. Hit low and knocked down by Park Williams, the man on the spot for Minnesota. Well, especially with facing a team with such great running backs as Rodgers and Mike Allstott, really put a lot of pressure on your middle linebacker, and Minnesota, frankly, going with its fourth string middle linebacker right now.
They like Park Williams, but very importantly, not only fourth string, to call the defensive line play, the linebacker play, and the secondary play. It's an awful big job for someone that hasn't been there yet.
Third and goal from the four. Fresker. Incomplete at the two-yard line. The ball batted up in the air at the goal line, and then it fell to the ground. Incomplete. Pass intended for Isaac Jones. Craig Sauer with the defensive coverage for Minnesota.
Purdue takes a chance here. They expect, as almost all teams play man-to-man inside the 15-yard line, the Gophers play a zone. They take a chance. They run the man underneath, who usually would be being trailed if they're playing man-to-man. The Gophers are playing a zone. There's Craig Sauer waiting for him. That's a good play by the Gophers. A bad read by Purdue.
Brian Alford, the intended receiver at the goal line. Here's Brad Bobbage trying a 22-yard field goal. Flags are thrown, no kick. Time on the play clock, so we'll assume there's movement on the line.
They're pointing to each other, as is typical.
That's usually the case. Bobbage has been just about perfect. His only miss this year, a costly miss for Purdue. He missed a 47-yarder. This penalty coming against Minnesota, it'll cut the distance to the goal line in half. I know that it'll change Jim Pauletto's strategy here.
Offside on the defense. Man jumps in the neutral zone and the offense reacted. 5 yards. Still fourth down.
That's the new penalty this year, or a penalty rule change from a year ago. And Jim Pauletto will leave the field goal team on the field. We're talking about Bobbage's only miss. What would have been a game winner against Michigan State on the final play of the game. This one, an easier kick, just 20 yards. And it's up and good. The Boilermakers are back in front, 10-7. 7:37 left in the second quarter. Purdue has never trailed.
Important play. We're going to see it again down in the goal line. Trefster makes a nice play action fake. The Gophers take a chance. They play zone. Usually teams play man-to-man here. They run Alford down all the way across from the top of the screen to the bottom. Usually the defensive back would have been chasing that play, but in this situation, Sauer's there waiting for him because he stayed in his zone on the backside. A big play call by defensive coordinator Mark Dove.
Bobbage's kick fielded by Early at the five. Rashawn Early brought down, a one-handed tackle by Lee Johnson. Last week, Johnson on the special teams ran one back himself for 99 yards and a touchdown. He made a great tackle on Rashawn Early.
As you said, just a one hand. That's a strong man because he just took him down in one hand, pulled him right on down.
Early had running room. He wasn't touched until he finally was touched by Lee Johnson. Good field position for Minnesota from the 34. Darkens. Close to a Minnesota first down. Got a little extra shove in front of the Minnesota bench. Derek Brown, their defensive offensively for Purdue, and it certainly looks that if Chris Darkins is not 100%, he's very close to it.
He's staying healthy. He's in the game. You can see all this is his speed. The play is designed to go. He's gaining yards the whole time. He gains about 9 yards in that play. He looks like he's going sideways. It looks like it might have been a late shot, but that's not. That's a good play by the defensive back. You want to get a hit on Chris Darkins every chance you get. That's a nice play.
Contact was made while Darkins was still inbound. Second and one. Sauter with a quick flip. This is Atwell. Sutter stepping his way across midfield before he's finally tackled from behind by Bill Wiklinski.
Design play. They see no one's covering out. Well, they give it to him right away. Again, here comes back. We got a block. He's got a block in front of him. Makes a couple nice moves. Then gets run down from behind. But again, that's what Atwell can do. If you can get the ball in his hands quickly.
Picked up a Minnesota first down into Purdue territory. Nobody in the backfield. Sauter with time. Deep for Atwell. Intercepted at the 18-yard line by Derrick Brown. Field is Atwell because he thought he had that ball and Brown took it right away from him.
He certainly did. He saw that play all the way. Sauter knew where he was going from the start. He's looking at Atwell the whole time. He's playing deep there and he comes across and this is how you're supposed to play. He reads the quarterback. You can see him looking. And here comes Burrows right there. Cuts right behind him. Takes that ball away. That's an outstanding play.
Derrick Brown with an interception, his second of the year. His first one was memorable. A 54-yard interception return in the fourth quarter against Notre Dame for a touchdown. This one, not much of a return, but a great interception nonetheless. And the Boilermakers have the football inside their 20. Presker has gone all the way so far for Purdue. Gets it out to the 25-yard line, a gain of about 8 yards before Crawford Jordan made the tackle for Minnesota. Let's go down to Mike Maddox.
Well, Dick and Keith, I don't know what it said, but Mike Allstott may run with the football a little bit differently. During that last possession when the Gophers had the football, his father passed him a note. The trainer gave it to Mike. He read it. I'm not sure, but I think it said something to the effect of, quit fumbling, Dick and Keith.
Fathers are always good for that type of advice, aren't they? Hands off to Allstott. Jumps over one man early. Gets a hold of him and wouldn't let go, but Allstott picks up a first down nonetheless out to the 33-yard line with 6:10 left in the first half.
Again, the Gophers are missing tackles. What the Gophers are doing now, they're bringing 8 men up to the line of scrimmage. They're going to have the challenge. And again, Trepsker's going to have an opportunity. When you try and shut down one phase of the game like the Gophers are trying to do with the running game with Allstott and Rodgers, you're leaving something else open. You're going to have to man your corners up, and we'll see what happens.
In every game for Purdue this year, Mike Allstott has rushed for over 100 yards. He already has 86 in this game tonight, and we're not yet to halftime. Presker deep across the middle. Picked up in the air by Blaine. Incomplete. The intended receiver was Brian Alford at the Minnesota 30-yard line.
On that play, Terrence Blaine got no inside help. He should have had inside help from early. The free safety, he didn't have any. He had man-to-man the whole way. That's an outstanding play by Terrence Blaine. You see there, he's got no inside help. He just comes across and makes that play. That's an outstanding read by Tresker, too. Anytime you have a man manned up like that, you want to give your receiver an opportunity to make a play. That's what Tresker did. The ball thrown out there was just an outstanding play by Blaine in that situation.
Second and 10 for the Boilermakers. Allstott. Find much running room, yet he picks up about 3 yards, falling across the 35 to the 36. Crawford Jordan and Ogun Akbar combined to make the tackle.
He shows you what a great player is in that situation. The Gophers get a good push at the point of attack that time. They bounce the Purdue lineman back into the backfield. He just slides right back down the field. We'll see right here. At the point of attack, he's stuck. He just slides back, finds a hole, and picks up 3 yards.
Third and 7. Minnesota Minnesota blitzes. Presker throws. Incomplete. Here comes the flag at midfield. Pass intended for Brian Alford. Crawford Jordan. Can't believe it. Not sure that that was a catchable ball. But I'm not sure it matters.
One of the biggest problems that time for the Minnesota Gophers is that they showed blitz way too early. Trexler knew before the ball was ever snapped they were blitzing. Rashawn Early snuck up to take the tight end. Trexler knew exactly where he wanted to go. He found that. And you see that there. There's a lot of contact there. That's a good call.
Yeah, it sure is.
As a defensive back, you cannot have your hands all over that receiver like that. That's a good call. The folks here don't like it, but that's a good call.
Goes the ball out to the 47-yard line. Minnesota blitzes again. Tresker throws. Incomplete. Charlie Stevens had the ball thrown behind him, and the pass was nearly deflected into the arms of Craig Sauer.
What's happening, the Gophers cannot stop Allstott on the run. They can't stop the run with Rodgers. They're going to have to take some chances. That time, they bring a linebacker. He gets a free read. He gets a free shot. But Tresker feels the pressure, gets the ball away first. He was lucky. The ball was in his hands, but it almost ended up in the defensive back's hand.
Asked Jim Coletto how he felt about his season. It appeared to me he's just about 8 points away from being 4-0. And he said, yeah, well, we're about 8 points away from being 0-4, too. Coaches are always a little apprehensive before game time. Second and 10 for Purdue. Rodgers hit hard by Sauer as he crossed midfield, a gain of about 4 yards. It'll be third down and 6.
Important play for both teams. Purdue wants to get a first down, keep their defense. Their defense has been spending too much time on the field. The Gopher defense has not been successful. This would be an opportunity to be successful, to get out, three and out. That's what they need to do.
Presker lines it. A bit too far for Corey Rogers at the 45-yard line. Jerome Davis covered him out of the backfield. It'll be fourth down and 6. You know, in the last couple of years, Keith, Gene Kady and Clem Haskins have had a hard time putting up more points than the Purdue-Minnesota football teams have put up. But so far, we've got a pretty good defensive struggle here.
We talked about it before. Both teams have felt like they've really improved defensively. So far, it's been shown.
Rodney Heath stands back at his 10. Rob Degnan averaging 42.5 yards per kick this year. Purdue's second punt. It is a good one. Beautiful spiral. With 4:05 left in the first half, a 10-7 Purdue lead. You see one of the advantages of indoor football, ceiling cam here at the Hubert H. Humphrey Metrodome. Minnesota has the ball deep in their own territory. First and 10, Darkin. As he gets about the 13-yard line. Tuki Wakori with the tackle for Purdue.
Tried a little misdirection that time. They had the big people in Cradible playing the fullback position. Really not very successful. Purdue does a good job. Again, the point of attack pushes things back. Darkins gets a couple yards.
Clock running about 3.5 minutes left in the first half. Four wide receivers, one running back. That's Chris Darkin. Sauter throws it away. A long ways away from any harm. And Sauter was spilled inside the 5-yard line. The Boilermakers put on some heavy pass rush on second and long.
The nice thing for Purdue, what they're doing right now, is they're getting an outstanding pass rush from just their down linemen. They don't have to bring linebackers at this point. No safety blitz. You see people are coming. That's an outstanding job.
Jamie Waschel, the first Purdue Boilermaker to make contact with Corey Sauter. Dangerous play for Minnesota. Third and 8. Deep in our own territory. Sauter evades the rush and throws another one away. Coming in, Joe Hayes. with Corey again putting pressure on Corey's daughter, and the Gophers will have to kick it away from near their goal line.
Purdue had an opportunity there, expecting the Gophers trying to get a first down to pass. They brought both outside linebackers, hoping they could force Sauter to make a bad decision.
Minnesota needs a good punt here, and punting has been a problem for the Gophers the last couple of years. Harmon will hit it near his 2-yard line. Fielded again on the run by Allen. Craig Allen to about the 35-yard line before Peter Hiestand finally finished him off. The Gophers not getting much distance nor height on their punts, and the Boilermakers will have great field position.
And that's the biggest problem, Dick. The Gophers punt cover team had absolutely no opportunity. That ball was kicked low, it was kicked short. Was able to take that on the run and get good yardage. They're inside the 30-yard line of the Gophers now.
Purdue hasn't had the best field position in this first half. Here they start at Minnesota's 29. Watson, the tailback. Not much running room off left tackle. Across the 30 to about the 28-yard line. Ralph Green made the tackle for Minnesota. Boilermakers with a win last week against Ball State, and one of the biggest wins, if not the biggest, in Jim Coletto's 5 years at Purdue, and their season opening win over West Virginia. Looking for their third win of the year tonight. Across the 25 to about the 22, Rodney Heath and Craig Sauer combine on the tackle for Minnesota. The clock running 2:10 left in the first half.
That's just power football, Dick. They line up with two tight ends, one running back. And again, the biggest surprise is that it's not all stop. Just handoffs, quick handoffs, straight ahead. That's just power football. We'll beat you, and Purdue's doing it right now. We'll just knock you back. And then you get a guy like Watson to break two tackles.
Rodgers, Watson, and Allstott are all in there. And it was Watson that got the call. He got across the 20. He needed to get to the 19, and it'll be close. First down, Purdue. They have all three running backs in the backfield behind Kresker on that play.
They certainly did, and they have two big people. Again, you're talking about Rodgers at 220, Allstott at 240. Big people.
Minnesota's defense has spent a lot of time on the field in this first half, and they've had to take a lot of punishment. That's the Boilermaker game plan. They wear you down. Allstock and Watson stacked in the eye behind Kresker. Park Williams came up from his linebacking spot. He hit Allstock head on and stopped him in his tracks.
This is how you fill a hole. The redshirt freshman linebacker comes up, gets underneath Allstott, takes his legs away from him. He's got nowhere to go.
A timeout is called by Purdue with 1:23 left in the first half. Go down to the field and Mike Max.
Well, Dick, so far we have seen Rick Dempster, quarterback for Purdue. Normally they like to get John Reeves in the first half. Before the game, I asked them what type of a system they have set up for that alternating quarterback process. They said, we have no system. We like to get Reeves in once in the first half, in the second half, because we think he's the quarterback of the future. But the problem is, when we're winning, as a coaching staff, we tend to get a little gun-shy and go with the guy who's got us the lead. That's been the case so far tonight.
We have seen Kresker go the whole way. You could see Jim Coletto not too happy with his team's execution in the last couple of plays.
Tremendously important play on first down. Coletto's mad because what happens, that limits now what Purdue can do, and who has the opportunity to strengthen this situation at second 11 yards is Bart Nubb, the defensive coordinator of the Gophers. He can blitz, he can bring people. He's got a lot of options. Coletto has, his options are limited by that poor first down play.
Second and 11. gets it inside the 10. He's very close to another Purdue first down.
Gokes are playing a soft zone. Trevor reads it. There's the man that's open. Don Williams took a bad route on that situation. He was in position that he should have been over there to take that play away, so he would have never had that opportunity to throw it there. He makes the decision to go for the interception. Obviously doesn't get it. There's a long game.
I'm not sure that Oliver Dottie got a good mark on that ball. He leaned the ball forward as he went out of bounds, and he ends up about a foot short. Oliver Dottie, as he went out of bounds, leaned the ball forward. I think a good yard ahead of where they ended up marking the ball.
A moment ago, we had advantage to Minnesota, but now it's advantage Purdue.
You look at Oliver Dottie here as he comes out of bounds. Well, he went out of bounds. His foot was out of bounds there, and it looked like he had the ball extended in front of him. Another yard or so. So instead of a first down, it's third and one inside the Minnesota 10. Allstott and Watson are split behind Prescott. Boilermakers are threatening to open up the game. Don Williams with the tackle for Minnesota.
That's a nice build for Don Williams coming in there, playing a quarterback position, getting involved in a throw like that for 1 yard gain. That's an outstanding play. Running the ball back. In a situation like this, there's 45 seconds left. It's second down and 4 yard line, but they can do basically whatever they want. They can take a chance with a play action pass here. They're probably going to catch the Gophers in a man-to-man defense. Again, the corners are going to want to help you. They know they need to with Allstott, but in a situation like this, you try and do too much and you get caught. Purdue's in a great situation with second and 4 on the 4 yard line.
Purdue has called a timeout. They have one left. Minnesota has yet to use the timeout. Both teams will play their homecoming games next week. Minnesota here against Northwestern. Northwestern, if you did not hear earlier today, beat Michigan in Ann Arbor. Purdue will play their homecoming game next week against Penn State, and the Nittany Lions lost for the second consecutive Saturday on their home field. So both teams have huge tasks facing them next week. Now second and goal, 45 seconds left. Rodgers smothered at the 2.
Purdue's just saying, we're going to line up. We think we're better than you are. We're going to blow you off the ball. 3 running backs. You know what we're going to do. We know what we're going to do. Try and stop us. That time.
Mark Williams made the tackle for Minnesota. And Williams really put in a tough spot here for Minnesota. He missed everything but one play last year in his freshman year. He was injured in the first play of the year against Penn State. Had reconstructive knee surgery. And was given an extra year of eligibility. So he still has 3 years left after this year. But the Gophers had to move him from an outside linebacking spot to the middle for tonight's game because of the injury to Ben Langford.
And Dick, they really like Park Williams. They feel he's going to be an outstanding player for a long time. But there's a couple things you said there. He got hurt the first play of last year, reconstructive surgery. He hasn't played a full football game for an awful long time. And now he's asked not only just to play the game, but to call the signals, the weak defensive signals from the sidelines, to make the adjustments when people go in motion. This is a big task. So far, he's done well.
Ben Langford, the starting linebacker, left the game with a separated shoulder. We'll try to get an update for you around the halftime. Certainly doesn't sound as if Langford will be able to return. The Boilermakers lead it, 10 to 7. They're out of timeout. The ball at the 1-yard line.
Who would you rather have in the backfield than Mike Allstott in this situation?
240 pounds of muscle. With Watson lined up behind him. Allstott leaps and scores. His second touchdown of the game. His 11th career touchdown against Minnesota. And the Boilermakers lead it 16 to 7.
See, Dick, he just had his fifth. This is his fifth consecutive 100-yard rushing game. He's on his way to having another career day against Minnesota.
Why is he ever?
And this was all set up again by the punt return, the short punt, the low line drive, and Purdue taking over the 20-yard line of the Gophers.
Don Williams hit him in the air, but Allstott so big and strong, he was able to work his way into the end zone. Bobich for the extra point. Up and good. Purdue had a 7-0 lead. Minnesota tied it, and now, late in the second quarter, 10 unanswered points. And the Boilermakers have a 17-7 lead.
To be in this football game, that's one of the things the Gophers cannot do, is they cannot let Purdue take over in good field position. They're just too strong, knocking the Gophers off the ball right now defensively. They're just too strong, and that man, it's too strong also. You'll see it again one more time from the top.
I think he might have a future in the National Football League. My goodness, what a package. 100 yards, 2 touchdowns, however, 2 fumbles that have helped keep Minnesota in this football game.
Exactly. If he did not have these 2 fumbles, which is tremendously unlikely for him to do, the score would be different.
His career best against Minnesota at West Lafayette last year, and he's on a pace to surpass that yardage total here tonight. 36 seconds left in the half. Bobich won't kick it deep, at least not in the air. Hit early on the face mask. Flag is thrown early, gets out to about the 20-yard line, but the Gophers may be pinned deep in their own territory. Is there a kicker who doesn't like to kick an artificial turf?
I haven't met him before.
Early was lucky he was able to hang on to that ball after it came up and hit him in the mask. Penalty will be marked off half the distance to the goal line, and that'll move the ball back to about the 7. So Minnesota, I'm sure, won't be too aggressive with their play calling here late in the half.
Going into halftime, the Gophers are the ones who really have to make some adjustments on defense. They have to find a way to shut down the running game, to make Tresker put the ball in the air. Purdue, on the other hand, has done well offensively, anything they want. Defensively, they had some trouble with Darkins, but overall, they've played well defensively.
First and 10, Minnesota, from the 7. Before Joe Hagan wraps him up. And the Gophers will be content to run the clock out here. Purdue can't do anything about it. They called their 3 timeouts earlier in the half. And the Boilermakers will head to the locker room, leading 17-7. A relatively low-scoring first half, given the history between these two teams.
welcome to a special halftime edition of the Sports Channel Report. I'm Steve Cashel. It's been a busy day in sports, so let's get right to it. We begin in Ann Arbor, Michigan, where Gary Barnett and his Northwestern Wildcats pull off another huge upset, beating Michigan. In doing so, the Cats break a winless streak in Michigan, dating back to 1959. Brian Griese starting again at quarterback for Michigan. They had a 3-0 lead in the first quarter when Tim Biakapatutka takes it 47 yards. What a great cutback here. Down to the Wildcat 14-yard line. Michigan then got it down to the Northwestern 2, and the defense comes up big. Biakapatutka stopped by Matt Fitzgerald and others. They held Michigan to a field goal. 6-0 Wolverine. Second quarter. Wolves led it 6-3. Wildcat forced the punt. Amani Toomer to field the punt. Oh, he fumbles. Recovered by Chris Martin. That set up a field goal, 6-6 to half. Second half, Michigan. Clarence Williams up the middle, 30-yard run down to the Northwestern 3-yard line. Then on third and goal for the men in blue, Greasy, the rollout, he's going to take it himself. Michigan led 13-6. Fourth quarter, Wolverines leading 13-9. Greasy is going to be picked off here by Eric Collier. And he's going to take it across the field down to the Wolverine 32. But it would set up Northwestern's game-winning touchdown. Steve Schnur here to Matt Hartle. 2 yards out, Northwestern 16-13 lead. They never look back. They win 19-13. The win ends a streak of 19 consecutive losses to Michigan dating back to 1965. Northwestern has now beaten Notre Dame and Michigan in the same season for the first time since 59. How about that? Two other Big Ten scores I want to pass along. Illinois wins its third in a row, beating Indiana. Final there, 17-10. Iowa over Michigan State, 21-7 behind Cedric Shaw, who rushed for 250 yards. Iowa is now 4-0. Wild won in Seattle as the Fighting Irish continue their quest for respect. Today, they went against the 15th-ranked Washington Huskies up in Seattle. Great, great football game here. Lou Holtz again looking out to the coach's box. Bob Davey running the show on the field once again for the Irish. Early fourth quarter, game tied at 14. Rashawn Sheehy takes the handoff up the middle untouched. Washington up 21-14. After the Huskies botched the punt, Irish ball in the 8. Ron Paulus to Autry Denson, the freshman. Touchdown 21-20. Notre Dame decides to go for two. Watch this. Derek Mays, bottom of your screen, all alone. Paulus to Mays. 2-point conversion. Irish up 22-21. Late in the fourth, though. Washington down to their 34-yard line. And look at that. Ball's overthrown. Alan Rossum, Notre Dame sophomore, down the sidelines, barely untouched. 76 yards for the clincher. 29-21. Notre Dame wins. Davey stays unbeaten as the man down on the field. Notre Dame now 4-2. Paulus finishing 12 of 28, 197 yards, and 2 touchdowns. At the outset of the season, the Big Ten championship looked to be up for grabs. But now the Ohio State Buckeyes have to be the clear-cut favorites to earn a trip to Pasadena on New Year's Day, if not for Northwestern, especially after swiping one today from Joe Paterno. Kajana Carter on the sideline today in Happy Valley. Third quarter, Ohio State up 4. Eddie George fumbles the ball, but it's ruled that he had a knee down after Penn State recovered. Big play there because the next play, Bobby Hoyne to Terry Glenn, 37-yard touchdown. Ohio State went up 21-10. Buckeyes' lead was cut to 21-18 when on a 3rd and 11, for the Lions, Wally Richardson just throws it up. Watch Bobby Engram here kind of push off and then get in front of the receiver. He grabs it down to the 2. Next play, John Whitman takes it in. Penn State led it 25-21, but Ohio State would come back. Eddie George from the 6. He ran this play last week, and they beat Notre Dame with it. 90 seconds to go. Buckeyes up by 3. John Cooper gets another one. 28-25, Boyne throws for a career-high 354 yards and 3 TDs. Ohio State now 5-0, and they win their Big Ten Conference opener. Penn State falls to 3-2. Michigan was not the only top 10 team to tumble this afternoon. We go to Boulder, Colorado. 4th-ranked Buffaloes got beaten by Kansas. Look at the Buffalo there. Runs over a Kansas player. First quarter, Colorado in punt formation. KU Spencer Barnes comes inside. Blocks the punt. Metalito Jones returned the block, 31 yards, 9-0 Kansas. Third quarter, 3rd and 10. Colorado's John Hessler finds Herschel Troutman on the sidelines, 24-23 Buffaloes. Coy Detmer goes in, but he collapsed under his own weight. He was forced to leave the game again. Fourth quarter, KU up 27-26. June Healy, 43-yard touchdown, 34-26 Kansas. They win 40 32-24. Kansas now 5-0, 1-0 in the Big 8. Snapped a 10-game losing streak to the Buffaloes. They have opened the season with 5 wins for the first time since 1968. The Florida Gators are breathing down the backs of both Florida State and Nebraska. Today, Steve Ferrer's team ranked third, won a big one at number 21, LSU. Fred Taylor, 4-yard touchdown, put Florida up 14-0 here in the second quarter. Still in the second again, they go to Taylor. This time, no problem getting in around their left side. 21-0, and Steve Spurrier's club have the offense rolling. Near the end of the first half, LSU would score as Jamie Howard hits Anthony McFarland. This gives a defensive tackle. That made it 21-7. Second half, after an LSU field goal, made it 21-10. Gators put it away. Danny Warfel here, finding Rydell Anthony in the corner of the end zone. Florida, big win away from the Swamp. 28-10. Florida improves to 5-0, 4-0 in the SEC. Elsewhere in top 25 action, top-ranked Florida State right now tied with Miami in the second quarter, 7-7. Fifth-ranked USC beating Cal, 12-7, third quarter. Earlier today, Texas Tech upset 8th-ranked A&M, 14-7 behind a 25-yard interception return with 30 seconds left. North Carolina pulls another upset, beating number 9 Virginia in the ACC. 10th-ranked Tennessee beat number 18 Arkansas. The 18 is Peyton Manning, tossed 4 touchdown passes in the first half. Number 11 Auburn wins at home by 28 over Mississippi State. Number 13 Kansas State shut out Missouri 30-0, while number 14 Oklahoma bounced back from last week's loss to Colorado. They beat Iowa State. Number 16 Alabama wins their 19th in a row over a non-conference opponent, beating NC State. The Ducks of Oregon, ranked 17th, Conference Pacific 45-7. Number 20 Texas, right now 4-1 as they rout Rice 37-13.
We're back at the Metrodome with Purdue leading Minnesota 17-7. Dick Bramer and Keith Nord, glad you're with us for Big Ten football from Minneapolis. Mike Maxx is down on the field, and he's got Purdue head coach Jim Coletto.
Coach Coletto, halftime, you go in with a 17-7 lead, and your game plan has worked before. Mike Alstead dominating.
Well, we played pretty good. Our special teams have hurt us with some penalties. This game's far from over, and we got to hold on the ball and not give it to them.
What do you need to do second half besides that?
Well, we've got to keep playing this. We're playing good defense. We got to keep doing that and keep the field position in our favor.
Very good. Thanks, Coach. Jim Coletto, coach of Purdue. One other note, Ben Langford definitely out for the game with a separated shoulder for the Gopher. They'll examine him on their side. The complete restraints for the rest of the season. Thank you, Keith.
Thanks, Michael. Coletto a little hoarse after the first half here at the Metrodome, and Jim Wacker might be a hoarse as well. He can't be very happy with the injury situation, the loss of Ben Langford, or the fact that if you look at Langford getting the treatment, the ice pack on that left shoulder, or the pass protection given his inexperienced quarterback Corey Sauter. Minnesota's been unable to do much through the air so far.
They haven't had the chance. Again, when they've thrown the ball, they made a couple nice completions, but they have not had the time at this point.
Bobbitt with the kick. Early, nearly ran out of bounds at the 1-yard line. Rashawn Early runs out of room at the 19-yard line. Lee Johnson finally chased him. And Early gets credit for an 18-yard return, on which he ran about 65 yards.
He's tired. He's glad. He's glad he's playing defense now, because, again, if he had to go right away, he would be tired.
Corey Sauter, 4 of 10 through the air in the first half. One interception on a ball that was pretty well thrown. Just a great defensive play by Derek Brown. And the Gophers, of course, start with Darkins in the backfield. Out of bounds at the 25-yard line. Derek Wilson was just standing along the sideline, and Darkins got tackled into him by Willie Burroughs. And one of the hardest hits of the night, Derek Winston.
He did not expect it coming before right. He took a shot. Again, you're going to see Darkin's speed. It's a nice block at the point of attack, but that's just outrunning linebackers. He just runs out O'Connor to the sideline, and you'll see right here Winston taking a hit.
Everybody okay?
Purdue will enjoy that tomorrow in the film. You can see Sauter checking off the line of scrimmage, moving his people around.
Second and two. Derek Winston.
I expect the Gophers will open it up a little bit more in the second half, pass more on first down, pass a little bit more on second down. That time, a nice tackle, first down, but it's a nice aggressive play by the cornerback.
And you see a play like that, Keith, and you think, okay, well, that's to set them up for a play later on, maybe a pump fake and a longer route.
You did. Again, that was a nice play by Sauter from the standpoint. He came up, he saw something that would be available. He moved his players around, got him in position, got a first down.
Dawkins. Well, he slipped a little bit as he tried to make his cut across the 35 to the 38. GKO Paper with the tackle for Purdue.
What happened that time is Purdue had a little bit better position at the point of attack. They came up, were on the outside, so Dawkins had a cutback and inside. Again, it's a four-yard gain, but Cheeky Okafor makes a nice tackle.
Dawkins hasn't had a chance to really break one.
Up Joe Hagans, who not only returns kickoffs, he plays linebacker, plays defensive back. He lines up as a right defensive end this time to put pressure on the quarterback. You can see him at the top, bottom of your screen there. He gets cut a little bit, but Sauter knows he's there, and he knows he's quick. Sauter gets the ball off. The one thing Corey did not do that time is did not have his feet set very well. He made a throw. There you see his numbers.
Before Willie Burroughs makes the tackle for the Boilermakers, a gain of about 7 yards on the play. Keith, how important is this first Minnesota possession of a half?
It's an important possession not only for the offense, but for the defense. The Gophers' defense need to know that the offense is going to do something for Purdue at 17-7. If they can stop here, get their ball back, make another 7 or 8 or 9 minute drive with Allstott and Rogers carrying the ball, that's a huge boost for Purdue. But they need to stop the Gophers now.
Second and three for the Gophers. The reverse fake to Atwell. Deep down the middle for Thelwell. Incomplete. He was double covered. Derek Brown and Derek Winston were both there. They did not fight on the double fake by Sauter.
They saw it coming. They've seen that play. They knew they had that option. Tries to make a nice fake. He starts out running slow, but this is a bad throw. This is a throw that should never have been made. The free safety's waiting for it the whole way. You see Thelwell going down. He knows the free safety's there. What he's trying to do is keep the free safety from making that interception. That's a ball that should have never been thrown.
The offensive player turned into a defensive player on that throw.
Exactly.
Third down and three for Minnesota. This is Raphael Cooper. Run for the backup running back for Minnesota inside the 35 to the 34. He was nearly trapped for a loss, but Derek Brown had to knock him down at the 34, but not until he picked up a Minnesota first down.
The Gopher offense has a lot of confidence. 2 weeks ago out of Syracuse, he fumbled the ball. He pulled it to the ground. Last week came back out over 100 yards, filling in for Chris Starkins. You see right there, he runs out of the tackle, gets hit a few more times here, keeps his feet moving, makes a spin move at the end. That's an outstanding run. And that's an outstanding hit, too, by Burroughs, comes up and really puts it on the ground.
First carry for Cooper. Thelwell with the catch. And the run to the 25-yard line. Willie Burroughs wouldn't let go. Gophers have run that play 3 or 4 times tonight.
They have. Purdue has seen it. They've seen it 2 or 3 times now. And that's a scary play because that's the same play before that Burroughs almost took away. So I don't know. If you go to the well one too many times, Burroughs is a good player. He may come back and take that one.
It's an awfully long throw for a quarterback to make.
It certainly is. Again, what they're doing, he's just running a stop pattern. He runs 5 or 6 yards to stop.
Second and less than a yard for Minnesota. Darkus has the first down. 15. O'Keefer made the tackle.
is a downfield block. And Tony Levine makes an outstanding block. Darkens cuts the outs and the speed's there. But right here, we may not see it, but Levine puts Burrows right there. He put Burrows in the ground, and that's what helped Darkens get that first down. Outstanding block by Tony Levine.
For Purdue, and there's an injured Boilermaker on the play, and it is Burrows.
This is exactly what Coach Toledo did not want to have happen. The Gophers to come out to get a long, sustained drive to start the second half, mixing it up well, running and passing. This is exactly what he did not want to have happen.
See if we can find out how Willie Burrows was injured. We'll update you on Burrows' status when we come back to Minneapolis in a moment. Minnesota threatening to put more points up on the board on its first possession of the second half. Second down and three.
Misdirection there. It's a straight through. They're bringing Cradible back on the backside, but he breaks through. Brush misses the tackle, and that's just quickness on Darkness.
Chalmers kick makes it a 17-14 game. Minnesota's opening possession lasts nearly 5 minutes, and it pays off in a touchdown. Chris Darkens getting some medical attention along the sideline. They are attending to his left hand, wrist, arm, shoulder, something. But he took it in from 7 yards out to put Minnesota on the board for the second time. Deep kickoff, a staggering start to the return. And Higgins still going, works it out across the 40 out near midfield. Got him. It wasn't certain after he caught the ball that Higgins wanted to take it out of the end zone, but I think he's glad he did right now.
He wanted to take it out of the replay. Lee Johnson wanted him to stay in there, but he decides he's going to. Again, this is the linebacker slash defensive end slash safety looking to move down the sideline. Exactly what Purdue needed. After the Gophers took the opening kickoff in the second half, marched it down, running the pass, their touchdown. Purdue comes right back, gets it to the 50-yard line. That's exactly what Purdue needed to do.
Last year, Higgins was using a lot of short yardage situations to score some touchdowns. Darkens and Allstott have been the featured players in tonight's game. Darkens with one touchdown, Allstott with two. He's the fullback. In front of Rodgers, who gets the football. And Rodgers chews up 5 yards on his first carry. Two of the best, if not in the nation, at least in the Big Ten. Mike Allstott and Chris Darkens, and look at those numbers. The difference, Allstott fumbled the ball twice. Darkens has not turned the ball over for Minnesota, but two of the game's best. It's fun to watch him run.
It sure is. We're seeing, like you said, two of the best. The big question was, would Darkens be healthy? He's proved that he is.
Second down and five for the Boilermakers. Trenster starts the second half. We've not seen John Reeves get in the game. Trenster going deep. It's caught at the 15-yard line. Brian Alford takes it down inside the 10. They'll mark it at the 3-yard line. What a throw by Rick Kresker.
It's exactly what we talked about, Dick. The Gophers know to stop Allstott, to stop Rogers. What they need to do is to put some pressure, fill the lines. You see Clark Williams blitzing, Consigas blitzing. They get a man-to-man coverage situation, and they just beat him.
Terrence Blaine made the tackle after Alford beat him for a big game. Inside the five. Allstott carries it across for his third touchdown tonight.
What an answer to the Gophers' long touchdown drive. Purdue comes right back, runs the kickoff to the 50-yard line. And just in a few plays, gets another touchdown. Outstanding play by Purdue.
Three plays, just over a minute taken off the clock, and the Boilermakers lead by 9. And Bonich will try to make it a 10-point lead. No problem there. A very quick answer for the Boilermakers. It's 24-14. Allstott, 240 pounds of brawn. Two Gophers hit him head on, and he still had the muscle and the leg drive to get it into the end zone. You know, a lot of times, Keith, they'll talk about fullbacks and how they're strong and they have a low center of gravity. It's like Allstott has a high center of gravity. He just is so powerful, he pounds his way for extra yardage.
He actually does. He has short legs and a long upper body. It's very hard to get a good hit on it, and all you hit is thigh pads or shoulder pads, and that's why people keep bouncing off.
Let's go down to Mike Maggs.
Well, a couple of quick injury updates, Dick and Keith. Chris Darkus just banged up. Nothing serious. He will return. On the Purdue side, Willie Burrow sustained an injury, it looks like, to the neck. They don't know if it's serious yet or not. They're checking to see if he has his full range of motion. May return to action yet tonight. Dick and Keith.
Thank you, Mike. 24-14 our score. Again, we'll kick it away. Rashawn Early and Raphael Cooper back deep from Minnesota. And again, Early will get a chance to run it back. It's inside the 20. Great play by Roosevelt Colvin on the special teams for Purdue.
Great coverage by Purdue. Rashawn Early makes a little bit of a mistake. The man is blocking him out, and he takes a cut to the outside, and that's what happens. He gets caught back in the 16-yard line. Interesting opening to the second half. Gophers come down, march it in. Purdue comes right back. Let's see how the Gophers offense responds now.
Darkins back in for Minnesota. To the 21-yard line, and right there to make the tackle, Willie Burrow. Nothing wrong with him. O'Keefer also there for Purdue. Good to see Willie Burrow back in the lineup.
He's made a lot of big plays today.
Darkins over the 100-yard mark. But the Gophers have not been able to do much in terms of passing the ball deep against this Purdue defense. And so far, it is a much improved Purdue defense over the defense Minnesota saw the last couple of years. Second and 6. Sauter looking deep, delivers to Cradwell, the tight end. He's got a Minnesota first down across the 30 to the 33. Bob O'Connor with the defensive coverage for Purdue. Minnesota hoped to throw a little bit more to their tight ends this year, and they have. Tight ends caught only 2 passes last year for the Gophers.
Levine cleared out on that one. Cradwell came back from underneath. Again, that was the second or third read for Sauter. It's a nice play, first down.
Levine, Woodson, Cradwell are all to Sauter's right, and there's a quick pass to Levine. He cuts upfield, is close to another Minnesota first down. O'Connor with the tackle for Purdue. It's going to be tough to stop that when a team sends 3 people
play. The Gophers have shown this all season long. In a situation like that, if they're going to come out and do that consistently, Purdue will go to a man-to-man, or they'll put a press line, a cornerback, or move a linebacker out on them to take that play away.
It is a Minnesota first down from Minnesota's 43. Hanging the tight end in motion. Darkins tries to spin away, but can't. O'Connor coming in, making a nice twisting tackle on Chris Darkins. Boilermakers. He has played a good game here tonight for Purdue. Helped Darkins to a gain of just a yard. Now in a likely passing situation, he'll check out of the game. And the Boilermakers bring an extra defensive back in. Nobody in the backfield behind Sauter. Bellwell with the catch. A cut upfield to the 45. He's got a Minnesota first down. Willie Fell, backup linebacker, made the tackle for the Boilermakers.
Purdue right now is not getting the same pressure they had in the first half. They give Sauter time to throw. He finds Fellwell. He gets the ball on the sidelines, makes one move, gets back up, gets the first down.
From the Purdue 45, Minnesota has the first down. Across the 40, leaps over the 30, sprints across the 20, and goes into the end zone. What a run by Chris Darkins. Darkins has two touchdowns tonight. Lost a shoe in the process. 156 yards rushing tonight for Chris Darkins. The offenses have opened it up in a more typical Purdue-Minnesota score. Each team has scored already in the second half. It's a three-point ball game. How many broken tackles?
He's got travel in front of him. He gets a good hole. Oh, keeper misses that tackle. He jumps over people. There's the man that should bring him down. He just keeps running.
Got his shoe.
They got his shoe. We're seeing through the best tonight, Jeff.
Jamel Coleman been able to bring him down near the 20-yard line, but Darkins with a very determined run here. And Darkins, who rushed for 234 yards against the Boilermakers last year, his career best, has turned it on here in the third quarter, and it's a three-point game.
The Gopher coaches play that over and over again, say what a great play. The Purdue coaches play that over and over again, and they are extremely upset. You just cannot give a man like that the opportunity to do that. You need to put him on the ground.
So you know you're a good football player when you've got somebody to tie your shoes for you. That didn't take long. Purdue scored in just over a minute. Minnesota scored in just over two. Schaumburg with a low line drive kick, and it'll go into the end zone. And it's a cutback. Good idea. Minnesota's had problems on their special teams coverage tonight. Here, Purdue will start from its 20-yard line. We made mention earlier that he'd not really had the opportunity to break three in tonight's game, but he certainly did there, and his rushing totals are pretty impressive.
Again, with Purdue's offense, if they can control the ball, they keep him off the field. That's what happens when he gets to the field. He has numbers like that. Now we'll see what Allstock can do, how he answers.
Fresco. Throws complete at the 20, incomplete, they say, at the 29-yard line. Oliver Dottie was the intended did not have possession as he went out of bounds.
Rodney Heath has excellent coverage there. It's a beautiful pass. See it a little bit better this time. I think the Gophers got one there. I think they took one away from Purdue in that situation.
That's a catch.
I think that's a catch too.
Second down and 10. Rodgers up to the 23, and that's all. Mark Williams and Antoine Richard combined to make the tackle for Minnesota.
The Gophers bring about 8 people up to the line of scrimmage. That situation, they're putting Rodney Heath out there man-to-man. They're saying, we're going to beat you man-to-man. We can cover you. You're going to see here Crawford Jordan comes up. He just comes up right there. Wait for him. Gets in on that tackle. That's a nice play for a cornerback to be making. 2 yards behind the line of scrimmage.
Third and 7. Presker was going to go from the shotgun, but he couldn't call an audible from the shotgun. Now he comes up under center. Tipped away by Rodney Heath at the 32-yard line, intended for Isaac Jones.
We talked about him earlier, Dick. He's leading the nation with 4 interceptions. He's playing with an awful lot of confidence right now. He makes a break. He'd like to have this one back. He'd like to think he might catch that ball.
Dagman standing inside his 10-yard line. Heath standing back at his 30 on 4th and 7.
Purdue needs a good punt, and they have Dagman, who's an outstanding punter.
Go for soft the return here, and Dagman's going to run for it. Rob Dagman with a first down. Into Minnesota territory at the 48-yard line. Set up a return that never came.
That is a tremendously gutsy call by Gleto. If he called that, I'm not certain that he called this. If he had called that, he would not be blocking that man outside. I think this is a play that Dagman made all by himself, and that's a gutsy play. It turns out standing if he doesn't make it. I think he did that on his own, Dick.
Joe Justice knocked him out of bounds. The Boilermakers have it at the Minnesota 46. Rodgers breaks a tackle and gets across the 45 to the Minnesota 43. Nice determined run by Corey Rodgers. Justin Conzenius finally knocked into the turf for Minnesota. And Jim Wackert is fuming. Finish to a great day of Big Ten football. Purdue with a 3-point lead, 2nd and 7. Gophers blitz. Presker gets rid of it. Incomplete. He threw a bullet to Alford, and Presker was flattened at the 47-yard line by Jerome Davis.
The Gophers are giving Presker some different looks now. They're bringing 9 men up the line of scrimmage. That time they did not blitz, they backed out into his zone late, but they're trying to make Presker have a little bit tougher read. You see them on the line of scrimmage, they block, they back out them. Davis that time puts a little bit of pressure at the end.
3rd down and 7. And the Gophers have 9 men at the line of scrimmage. Presker, an inside pass. Rodgers is smothered at the 45. Rodgers. Rodgers did all he could to catch the ball because there was no running room at all. He had to catch the ball and run into the pile.
In that situation, it turns out to be great strategy. If they break through that first line of defense, there's no one back there to run them down. So it worked that time. It could cost the Gophers later.
Dagnan, we think, is going to punt. Heath is back at the 10-yard line.
Chris Darkins into the secondary. He's a big man, extremely fast. You can see the linemen doing a good job. Look at how they wipe out. And there we go, right there. Derrick Brown, that's hard to do all by yourself.
The Gophers had three tight ends blowing out the left side of the Purdue line. Second and one. Darkins falls forward across the 30. Looks like he'll have Minnesota first down. He was tackled by Darnell Howard.
A little misdirection that time. They bring a tight end back. They bring Tangen back in motion. Bradley goes the other way. It's a first down, but those are tough yards. On defense, Dick, you can play with emotion. In offense, you have to be a little bit more controlled. But you're looking at some defensive players right there.
Has never led in the game. The defensive unit for Minnesota did its job, and now Corey Sauter, a bit confused, will call a timeout with 2:44 left in the third quarter. Minnesota has the ball now, but Purdue's had three possessions. Mike Allstadt has carried the ball, touched the ball just once in the second half.
I can't understand why Coletto has gone to that kind of a strategy. All first half, Purdue did anything they wanted with Rodgers, Watson, and all stopped running the football, did not have to throw the ball much. When they did, they were tremendously successful. But it all starts with Allstott. Give him the ball, let him pound for 7 or 8 yards, and everything works off that. Your play action passes, your runs to Rodgers. They've gone away from him. I can't believe they'll stay away from him for too long.
Purdue 2-1-1 on the season. This is, they are hoping it will be their first Big Ten win of the year. A great win for them right out of the gate, beating West Virginia, ranked 23rd in the nation at the time. Purdue winning on the road there. Gave Notre Dame a very good game. Had the game tied late in the second half. And ended up just running out of time at the end of that game. And Michigan State with the tie against Purdue and the win over Ball State. We opened up Minnesota's season here. Minnesota winning that game. Minnesota losing on the road at Syracuse and then the drop last week over Arkansas State. 10 Gophers.
Sauter's called the new play at the line of scrimmage.
Darkins bursting through the middle, across midfield. A 20-yard gain before he's finally hauled down by Willie Burrow.
Sauter sees something he likes at the line of scrimmage. He checks off, makes the call. Straight up the middle of the dark, and Gophers' offensive line is starting to manhandle Purdue's defensive line. It was exactly the opposite in the first half, but it's turned around in the second half.
189 yards so far for Chris Darkins. Yet the Gophers trail by 3. A huge hole. Darkins with 15 more. Derrick
what's happening right now. A little misdirection play. There's Tang, and he's looking for somebody to block. He thinks the Darkins runs through him beforehand. Tang was trying to find somebody. There was nobody for him to block.
You saw Darkins leave the game for good cause. 143 yards in the third quarter. And we still have over 2 minutes left in the quarter. 2 weeks ago, Darkins carried the ball 33 times for 205 yards. And after the game, Jim Wacker said, well, that really was too much. Darkins ideally would touch the ball for Minnesota 25 to 30 times. Well, I think Darkins wants the ball right now. Raphael Cooper tries the middle. Not much there. He got to about the 32, a gain of a yard or so, and that'll be the extent of Raphael Cooper's playing time on this drive. Darkins with 28 carries already in the game, and we'll take a look at Mike Giovanetti, who is down on the deck at the 32-yard line. Part of a rebuilt offensive line for Minnesota. He's one of the few players up there with much experience.
He's played well this second half. They've been running a lot of plays his way. That's one thing the Gophers don't need when they often have the offensive line clicking like this now, is to lose one of their starters.
He's number 70. Look along the left side of your screen. Right there, a Purdue defensive lineman was pushed back to the back of Giovanetti's legs. And they are concerned about the right leg of Mike Giovanetti. Ben Lankford's already lost for the Gophers. He's with Mike Max.
Yeah, and you can't afford to lose too many regular. Ben Lankford, first of all, give us an update on the separated shoulder.
Well, separating, they're saying hopefully Michigan State will be able to come back and play, but next week doesn't look too good.
Park Williams has gone in and instead. No experience until this week playing middle linebacker. Done quite a job.
Oh, he's doing a great job. He's gone in and made some plays, and he's got a lot of enthusiasm. The other guys are helping him out, so he's really playing good.
The feeling on this sideline is that you will shut down Purdue, and you will win. That has been what the coaches have been preaching.
Yeah, that's what they're saying. We're going to shut them down, and our offense is going to keep pounding them. So hopefully they'll give up, and we'll just run right over them.
Good luck, Ben. Back up to you, Dick and Keith.
All right, thank you, Mike. Second down and nine for Minnesota. Nobody in the backfield. And now, whistle is blown. There was time left on the play clock. And a Purdue timeout, their second of the second half.
That may cost them. I'm not sure what the Gophers had called there. The Darkins was left uncovered. They had no one covering Darkins. The Purdue defense saw that, a very wise timeout. It may cost them later, but that was a smart timeout in that situation with Darkins uncovered.
Now Purdue is left with just one timeout for the balance of the game. Minnesota trailing by three. About 42,000 here at the Metrodome tonight. Minnesota's homecoming next week against Northwestern. Purdue's homecoming next week against Penn State. The shockingly winless Penn State Nittany Lions in Big Ten play. They are 0-2 in the Big Ten. A big game for both these teams. The way the conferences played so far this year, either one of these teams has any bowl aspirations or any aspirations for a winning record. This is a pivotal game for both teams.
Purdue plays Ohio State, Penn State, Michigan. 3 out of the next 4 weeks, extremely tough schedule.
Now Darkins is in the backfield behind Sutter. Not any longer. Sutter zips it. Separated from the ball by O'Keefer at the 26-yard line. What a hit by G.K. O'Keefer.
That's the kind of hit that can get a whole defense turned around. Big play coming across the middle. Thelwell gets up. Give him credit because he gets right back up.
Let's look and listen to the hit taken by Ryan Selwell.
Those two were roommates, Dick. I'm not sure if they will be after today.
At the 20, he normally sure-handed Ryan Selwell has had a very difficult night hanging onto the football here tonight.
Purdue playing a zone. Selwell makes the gun throw him wide open, drops the ball. Tremendously important situation.
The Gophers will go for an attempt at a tie from the 39-yard line. Harrison Harmon will hold Mike Chalberg's field goal attempt. His career long of 46. And we are tied. That had about 10 or 15 yards to spare. A booming field goal by Mike Chalberg. And we are tied at 24. Ago, the game was in the 50s. Last year, the game was in the 40s. And it looks as if this one is headed for the 30s, if not beyond.
We talked about how Purdue came out and they went away from their first half game plan. Allstott carried the ball, touched the ball one time. They need to get back, give the ball to Allstott, run the ball, letting Corey Rogers run, use the play action passes. They need to get back to what they do best, and that's run the football with Mike Allstott.
Now, Keith, it's just speculation, but Mike Allstott, as we mentioned, has been bothered by some sore shoulders. And we've been told by the Purdue people he was not looking forward to coming in here and playing on this artificial surface because he injured the shoulder on the artificial turf in the West Virginia game. And perhaps somewhere along the line, the shoulder injury has been aggravated. Nonetheless, we'll expect to see him carry the ball quite a bit for the balance of this game.
I would think so. The way the Gophers have come back this second half, I would think Leto would go back to what they do best. If they don't, then I think you're probably right, Dick. Something is wrong. But I would think, I expect to see Allstott.
Schaumburg will kick it away. Lee Johnson, Joe Hagan's back. Johnson takes this one. 2 yards deep out of the end zone. Flag is thrown. Johnson still running across the 30 to the 32, but we'll check out the penalty. Purdue has been penalized on two prior kickoff returns, and that appears to be the case again here. The same call on three different kickoff returns. It back to the 17-yard line. Bob DeBess, offensive coordinator for the Minnesota Gophers. Happy with the way the offense has performed, and because of that, the defense has had a chance to rest up a little bit in this third quarter.
We talked about how important that is. Again, the Gopher offense moving the ball, giving the defense a breather. Now the defense needs to come up. Purdue offensive line controlled the game in the first half. They need to go back to what they do best. Run the ball.
Rogers. Hit head on by Crawford Jordan, but he muscles his way across the 20, up to the 23-yard line. In the first half, Allstott carried the ball 21 times for 100 yards. He's had just one carry for 3 yards in the second half. Might be the last play of the third quarter. Prester escapes the rush and throws complete to Alford. right hand. He came back for the football.
What happened in that situation? Presker's in trouble. He's fine running on. Offer does the exact correct thing. Comes back to the ball. Just coming back to the ball. Presker finally finds him. And then it's a foot race. Offer to win back the ball. There's a mistake there by Early, and now it's a foot race.
It was a 17-point quarter for Minnesota, but a big momentum changer on the last play of the third quarter in Purdue's favor.
I see Trusker going back. He can't find anybody. The Gophers have about two or three chances here to put him on the ground. They don't do it. Trusker makes a nice play to get open. Offer makes a great play to come back to the ball, and then it's a foot race.
Rashawn Early's kickoff return, he brings it back to the 29-yard line, and Minnesota will start from there. Derek Brown made the tackle for Purdue on the special teams. Crowd of just under 40,000 to paid attendance here tonight, and it has been fun to watch. You like nothing but watching good, talented running backs. Been given a treat here tonight. Sauter hands off to Darkins. A cut inside to the 35. Momentum out to the 40s, close to a Minnesota first down. Derek Brown with another tackle. For those of you in the state of Indiana watching this, you might have a hard time believing that Chris Darkins was somewhat questionable all week long for this game because he carried just 3 times for 9 yards in last week's game because he has shown no evidence of having any hamstring injury at all.
We talked to the coaches during the week and they said that he was really the best judge. He's a sprinter on the track team. He's the one that could tell them whether or not he was ready to play. He told the coaches he thought he could give it a try, and obviously he's done pretty well.
It wasn't questionable whether he would play, but certainly questionable how much he'd be able to play and how well. It is a Minnesota first down. Sauter sets up, delivers to Thelwell, who drops another one. He has fumbled once. He has dropped at least 3. And as memorable as Thelwell's season was up to this point, this is a night he'd love to forget.
They've run this play a number of times. Sauter just takes a step back. Thelwell's right there. The ball's there. This is a situation you have to decide at some point. If someone's hurting your team, you put someone else in. Thelwell's an outstanding big play receiver. If he can make the big play, he has to make that play.
Another first down. Inside the 40 to the 38-yard line. Wakori made the tackle for Purdue, and Darkins is getting close to another career best against the Boilermakers.
The Purdue defensive line just cannot hold up right now. You see the Gophers, they're just taking over. At the point of attack, Jenkins taking 2 men with him. Darkins, the great running back, is he a Snellwell making a nice block downfield. Purdue has to start doing some things. They're not stopping running game. They have to start taking some chances to try and shut down Darkins. That will leave them open for a big play.
Cooper in the game for Minnesota in lieu of Darkins, and he gets the call. To the 35-yard line, a short game. Pick up those 2 yards for Raphael Cooper. We've not seen Javon Jackson, who also carried the ball and did a fine job in place of Darkins last week against Arkansas State. Second and 8 for Minnesota. They trail 31-24. Prattville in motion, and the Boilermakers come offside. Greg Smith saying, "I didn't do it." He did.
centers get away with sometimes. He got away with it there. He will not get away with it again, I don't think.
13:36 left. Second down and three. Darkin back in the game now. Hope to get the payoff there on third and short. Second and short, excuse me.
The same play that they just ran that Thelwell dropped, they fake that one. Thelwell beats his man. The pass is just a little too long.
He was there. Great effort by Thelwell and Sutter. Overshot his man. Third and three. Sauter throws. Thelwell with the catch. He had a knee down. He's down at the 24, but he gets a Minnesota first down. Undaunted by Thelwell's frustrating night catching the ball, Sauter goes right back to him. They are roommates during the week. And Thelwell redeems himself with a catch and a Minnesota first down.
I'm sure the coaches want to get the ball back to him right away. Let him get a ball, get some confidence, because they're going to need him later on in this football game. Purdue has surprised me. They have not done a lot of blitzing yet. They have not come up with something. I would expect they would have tried something different to shut down the Minnesota attack. As of now, they have not done that.
Now Minnesota is forced to take its second timeout of the half. 13:06 in what looks to be a great finish here in Minneapolis. Nick Bramer and Keith Knorr, glad you're with us for Purdue against Minnesota. The Boilermakers have not stopped the Gophers in the second half. They've not forced a punt. First and 10. Shortened performance last week, but 260 yards the following week, I would think, would put him back in Heisman contention. The penalty will be put into effect on the kickoff, so the extra point stands. We are tied at 31. I'm not sure Chris Darkins was even touched on this touchdown run. What a romp for Chris Darkins.
His speed, he comes outside, and then it's just a foot race.
He wasn't. I don't think he was touched.
We'll see it again. Here's Mark Tangen. This is one of the reasons they're being so successful. 280-pound tight end in Matt Ream. Tangen comes down, 250 pounds. The last block, there it is. It springs Darkins for the long touchdown run.
Gophers have to kick it away from the 25. Chalmers boot high and deep. Johnson takes it from the 12. He went 99 for a the score last week. He gets it out to the 37, and that's where the Boilermakers will start this drive with 12:52 left. Rafael Cooper with the tackle on Minnesota special teams. Darkins approaching a school record for yards gained, and look what they have done in the respective halves. Darkins with nearly 200 yards rushing. In the second half, Allstott with just one carry for 3 yards. He's the only back lined up behind Rick Kretschke. His second carry of the half. And he falls across the 40. Tackled by Ogun Akbar of Minnesota. Pick up of 4 yards on the play.
Purdue brings the big tight end in, the two big tight ends. They just say, we're going to play with you. All stops straight ahead, and there's 5 yards. That's what they need to get back to doing to keep Minnesota's defense on the field and Darkins off the field.
Second and 5. Four-man rush. Trester to the sideline. It is incomplete. The pass intended for Edwin Watson. Coming out of the backfield.
That's a nice read by Trester. What happens? The Gophers show blitz. They come out late. They're playing a zone. He reads it well. He wanted to go to the curl pattern. He made the decision to go to the out pattern, the flat pattern. A nice throw. The ball's dropped. That's what the Purdue offense cannot afford at this point.
Trester has gone all the way for Purdue. Jim Coletto usually likes to alternate quarterbacks. John Reeves runs the option, but we've not seen Reeves here tonight. Third down and 5. Gophers blitz. Pass complete to Allstott. He's got a Purdue first down into Minnesota territory at the 46. Park Williams tackled him. We talked so much about Mike Allstott and his running ability. He is a very good pass receiver as well.
This is a nice play by Purdue. The tight end comes down. He picks Park Williams. Allstott gets the flat. Park Williams can't. Every pass play he could find that was designed for a fullback. That's how much faith he has in the hands of Mike Allstott. Second and 7.
Purdue first down. Rashawn Early pinned him down. It looks as if he's a yard and a half, 2 yards short of first down yardage.
Prester makes a nice call. Jones just runs a little square out and turns back out. He loses Heath, who comes up and makes a nice hit there. But it's a nice play, a nice pass, a nice catch.
Just under 10 minutes to play in the fourth. This is Watson. Watson muscles his way down to the 5-yard line. Antoine Richard with the tackle for Minnesota, but it's a Purdue first down, and another Minnesota player is hurt. This is Rashawn Early. Bent in half at the 8-yard line.
Purdue is getting back to what exactly they did well right in the first half. Smash mouth football. Line up. We're going to take you man-to-man. See who's best right now. Purdue's playing better.
9:48 left in the football game. We're tied at 31. With Keith Nord and Mike Mack, Dick Bramer from the Metrodome in Minneapolis. It has been a typical Purdue-Minnesota game. 31-31. 48 left in the fourth quarter. The Boilermakers are driving. Watson and Alston now line up in the eye behind Preston. It's Watson. To the line, the scrimmage, and that's it. Mark Williams. A whole host of Gophers. Peter Hestand is there. Antoine Richard. They will give forward progress to the pool. Second down and goal. Mike Alstott has already scored 3 touchdowns here tonight. A dozen touchdowns lifetime against Minnesota. He's in the middle between Watson and Rogers. Tester looks to the end zone. Scrambles his way.
I like the call. They put the 3 backs in the backfield. They're trying to pass. The tight end's covered. He makes a play out of nothing and gets into the end zone. Well, I don't like the decision of the play, but boy, I'll tell you what. That's an athletic play by Rick Trester.
37-31. 38-31. 8:59 left. The last 2 Purdue touchdown teams have been scored on some great improvisation by Rick Tresker. The long touchdown pass to Alford, and then this mad scramble up the middle from 4 yards out.
He's trying to find the tight end here. He's covered. The Gophers do a good job, but Tresker finds a hole, gets in between, and watch him reach out, stick the ball across the goal line there. I think that's what Coletto didn't like, as the ball bounced down. Touchdown. That's a big play.
Same spot in the field, or same end of the field last year, where Minnesota was involved in a controversial call, a similar call. The Illinois player did fumble into the end zone, but yet was given credit for the touchdown, and Tresker did lose the football momentarily, but it came right back to it. Just under 9 minutes to play. Purdue has never trailed in this game.
They certainly responded well after the Gophers came out in their third quarter. And just the Gophers offensive line just took over the game. Chris Darnton took over the game. Purdue went 3 and out a number of times. They came back on a drive that time. Just that was such an important drive for the Purdue offense, for the Purdue team.
Bobich will kick it away. Cooper standing back at his 5. Cooper. Raphael Cooper leads his way across the 30 out to the 34, and the Gophers will have their field position with 8:52 left. Joe Hagan, only 5 that we called his name here tonight. He made the tackle for the Boilermakers. How much is left of
sore hamstring. Once you are fatigued, the hamstring's always more likely to be injured. So, yeah, that's a big question. They have the power team in. They have the three tight ends in.
Gophers a little confused as they set up for this first down call. Darkens with the delay. And they're waiting for him at the 35-yard line. The first man there is Willie Burroughs. And for the first time, perhaps in the second half, the Boilermakers have stopped Chris Darkens. Time now to take a look at our MSC Heartland Chevy Geo Game Summary. Chris Darkens with a career-high 260 yards, 6 yards short of the school record for yards gained in a game, and Mike Allstott having another fantastic game against Minnesota. Brought to you by your Heartland Chevy Geo dealers. Cradwell in motion, and again, Purdue comes offside. Jamie Waschel broke across the line. Wiggle of the football, and the Gophers got caught.
He got away with it once, not a second time.
Second and 14.
You would typically think this is a passing situation, Dick, but the way the Gopher offense has been running the ball, it may not be.
Nobody in the backfield. Quick dump to Tutu Atwell. He runs toward the sideline. Top to the 30.
In the second half, he's given him better protection. He has taken a couple of deeper drops. You're right, they have. The one thing Purdue has not done yet, we'll see if they do it now in a big third down situation, is blitz. They haven't blitzed at all.
They come with a four-man rush. Sauter throws complete to Johnny Woodson at the 46, and that's a Minnesota first down.
That's a name that you haven't heard a lot this year so far. But he comes through, makes a good catch. The ball's thrown low like it should be in that situation. Sauter's trying to protect the ball. Purdue drops back into his zone. Woodson goes down. Instead of trying to make the catch and continue running, he drops down, protects the ball, keeps the Gopher drive alive.
Just under 7 minutes to play. Darkens across midfield, and he's just broken Kent Kitzman's school record for yards gained. Minnesota's fullback back in the late 70s rushed for 266 yards against the Illini. Back in mid-November of 77, Chris Darkens has just set a school mark for yards gained in a game, and chances are he's not done for the night. Pickup of 7. Darkens unofficially has 268 yards. Picked it up. He had a knee on the ground, and it'll be a loss of a couple. It'll be third down and 5.
The Gophers are setting up the same play they've run so successfully. This time, Sauter drops the ball. Lucky to get back on top of it.
5:48 left. Thing Minnesota wants to do is score quickly.
Good point.
Might be the team with the ball last in this game wins. There's a Darkens night tonight. And now a timeout is called by Purdue, and that's their last of the half. So again, some confusion along the line of scrimmage. Minnesota, the only team left with a timeout remaining. 5:33 left. The Gophers trail by 7.
Hey, welcome back to the Met Fair Dome. Purdue leading the Gophers 31-24. You saw Rashawn Irving go down. The gift in the sternum is okay. Probably will return tonight. Purdue, for the first time in the second half, adjustments, trying to stunt where they think Darkins will run. We'll see if it works. Dick and Keith.
Third and five. Darkins checks out of the backfield. Sutter throws complete to one side of the 40. It's another Minnesota first down. And Willie Burroughs has been a very busy man in the Purdue secondary tonight. Another tackle for the Purdue safety.
Down another big catch by Johnny Woodson. Not an easy catch for the first down yardage.
First and 10 Minnesota from the Purdue 40. Kind of in motion. Darkins cuts back upfield and gains about 3 yards. The keeper puts him up near the line of scrimmage. Darkins fell forward. Bill Wiklinski also another tackle for Purdue.
Purdue did much better job at the point of attack that time. They strung it out. The one thing you don't want to do is you want to get Darkins to be going sideways, east and west. Once he turns it up, he uses that outstanding speed. He runs away from people, even people that have the angle on him. You want him to go east and west, back to the sideline, not upfield.
Clock is running. 4:35 left in the game. Purdue leading 38-31. Kiefer was there. Jamie Wachelle, I think, was the first player to touch Darkins in the backfield or at least disrupt his running route.
And that's why the defensive play was so successful. Wachelle got back, made Darkins bounce out around him. And again, then Purdue is great pursuit to slow it down. You see Wachelle coming through, gets a hand on Darkins. He makes it bounce up. Oh, Kiefer's there. We're going to see Brown come in, put in on him. That's great team defense by Purdue.
Another big third down for Minnesota. Third and 7. Sutter throws. Complete to Woodson. Another Minnesota first down. Keith, the great irony here is Ryan Caldwell's had a very frustrating game for Minnesota. He has been a very good possession receiver for the Gophers over the last 2 years. Johnny Woodson has had a horrible time hanging on to passes. And here in the fourth quarter, it's Woodson who's made the big catches.
3 times in a row, they've gone to Woodson, showing a lot of confidence in him. I'm not sure whether it's that. I don't think it's the secondary coverage. They're not rolling his own to Thelwell. It's the same coverage on both sides. They've just found Woodson, and he's come up with the plays.
From the Purdue 29. Darkins across the 25 with a flag thrown back at the 28.
Playing with a lot of emotion now and playing very well for Purdue is Brown. He's coming up in that free from safety position. He's making tackles in the backfield, 2 and 3 yards deep. He's playing well for Purdue.
It's a 5-yard offside call against Purdue. So it will be 1st and 5 for Minnesota.
First and five is a situation where you have an opportunity to do some fun things offensively. You can go to the end zone. You can try a couple different things on 1st and 2nd down.
It will be 1st and 5 for the Gophers with 3:11 left. Single setback behind Sauter. Darkins, the first down. Down to the 10-yard line. A touchdown saving tackle for Jamel Coleman.
We said it before, Dick. The Gopher offensive line has taken this game over in the second half. Chris Darkins. The tackle pulling, pushing out, great block on O'Keefer, and then Darkins uses speed. Brown comes up from the free safety position. That's a hard tackle to make when a man like that's running at full speed.
2.5 minutes to play. Darkins leans forward to the 6. He couldn't get back outside. Had he been able to bust outside, he had had the end zone, but Willie Burroughs wouldn't let him go.
He looks a little tired on that play, Dick, and I guess there's probably good reason for it.
37 carries tonight for Chris Darkins, just under 300 yards. Clock running, 2 minutes to play. Stiff arm might have gotten him into the end zone. The ball marked inside the one. Third down.
If Sauer sees what he saw before the first sneak.
There it is. Touchdown, Minnesota. It's 38-37. In the Michigan State Purdue game a couple of weeks ago, Jim Pelletto was faced with this exact situation with 1 minute 46 seconds left. Pelletto opted to go for the 1-point conversion, and the game ended in a 35-all tie. Pelletto said it was because it was the Big Ten opener. He didn't want to gamble. This is Minnesota's Big Ten opener, and the fans want Jim Wacker to go for it.
No matter what happens here, Dick, I think this is the right call. A minute 38, you have an opportunity to win the football game. You go for the win in this situation.
Now, Jim Wacker wants the crowd to quiet down. You wonder, Minnesota's got a timeout left. Might be worth it to take the timeout to give Darkins a rest.
They are running out of time now. They have 10 seconds of the play clock.
5 seconds, and Sauer takes the timeout. With 1 second left. And now, Sauer will come to the sideline, but perhaps more importantly, Chris Darkins will have a full minute to catch his breath. He has 38 carries tonight for 294 yards.
This has been a really a tale of two halves, Dick. Purdue in the first half did not get many points. Again, we go back to All-Star fumbles. Fumbling twice, they were running the ball well, really controlling the line of scrimmage. In the second half, the Gophers offensive line has really taken over. They've done the same thing. Nobody's put the ball on the ground, and they put a tremendous number of points on the board.
2 years ago, 59-56 Minnesota. Last year, 49-37 Purdue. Very entertaining to watch. And we may have a lot of football left to play after this apparent 2-point try for Minnesota. Allstott has had a great game. Chris Darkins has had a better game.
We talked about the fact that we were going to see two of the best backs, not only in the Big Ten, but in the country. They certainly have lived up to the billing we gave them, Dick.
Darkins the only man on the backfield. Minnesota has never led in this football game. All night long, he's tackle Higgins and run to the 40-yard line before he could find someone to block.
He finally found Schaumburg.
From Minnesota's 45. From the shotgun. Prisker throws. Complete to Alford.
Tremendously important to remember, Purdue has no timeouts. They use them up in some situations when they shouldn't have used them.
Up of 5 yards. Allstock to the 37-yard line. The clock will continue to run inside of a minute. It'll be 3rd and 2. Allstock with a first down. That will stop the clock at the 36. Take it to 31-yard line. All right, a few moments ago, we told you about the Michigan State-Purdue game. It tied at 35, and we talked with you about Coletto's decision to go for one. Bobich missed a 47-yard field goal in that game as time ran out to force the tie. If they took a field goal attempt right here, it would be about the same range. Allstott right up the middle to the 25-yard line. Third down coming up. Purdue's trying to put Bobich in better position. The ball down, and this might be it. This might be it. It's fourth down. They've just downed the ball. And here comes Bobich. He missed the 47-yarder 2 weeks ago, which was ironic because his dad played for Michigan State. Now a chance to win the game. Degnan will hold. It'll be a 43-yard attempt. Minnesota wins.